about the digestive system or the mind and the digestive system. I'm going to try and link and connect as many things about how the mind affects the digestive system as I can in an effort to see whether we can develop some sort of useful therapeutic principles as to how to deal with people's minds or help people's minds to try and minimize digestive system problems and identify what such questions as I have given everybody on this little list of 21 questions. Has everybody had a bit of a glance at it?
Questions, but word answered.
Well, these are the, that's what we're going to explore today. I'm going to actually hopefully cover all of these things in these questions or discuss all of them, but that doesn't mean that I'll have solutions or answers to all of them, but we can try. When I talk about the mind, I'm going to talk about the mind a little bit more than I did last time, because I have been looking at the mind in a deconstructed way, as I mentioned last time, which is looking at some of the different attributes and different aspects of thinking, partly because I think it is much easier for us to treat those individual aspects. For example, if a person has unhealthy attitudes, just thinking that the person has, say, a personality disorder, I don't think helps with dealing with the specific problem of their attitudes, or if they're disturbing memories, or if they're worrying about something in the future. One has to identify whether it's a problem with the person's beliefs or the person's emotional reactions, etc., to be able to really helpfully develop any therapeutic ideas. So I'll explore that more, but with the mind, one looks at beliefs, emotions, attitudes, ideas, etc. The mind is, of course, inextricably connected with the brain and activity of the brain. And that's a little map that I showed everyone last time. I like these little maps, but they don't explain. They're simplifications, obviously, even though they look messy. There's a lot more to the mind than beliefs, attitudes, and interests. But the basic principle that I'm trying to show in this is the fact that the mind affects the brain affects the body, and then activities, which are something that the body does, then affect the mind again. But you can also look at arrows going around the other way. Okay, so the mind also directly, well, it affects the body through the brain, obviously, but the body also affects the brain. Things of the physiology, for example, your heart beating fast can then affect your emotions and your mind. Likewise, if a person has a digestive pain that is originating from the digestive system, it's not necessarily caused by the mind, but it causes a reaction in the mind. And that itself, so you can get different circles or connections of influence that way or that way. Okay. So it's just showing that it's a dynamic thing, it's changing all the time. Today, specifically, we're going to look at the digestive system. And the digestive system, as everyone will know, is particularly influenced by the autonomic nervous system. But it's looking at the general principle, a physiological principle, you can look at our physiology as for the chemical aspects and the electrical aspects. I mean, obviously there are other aspects of physiology, but when you look at the electrical connection, we're looking at the autonomic nervous system with the gut, and chemically there are also neurohormones and peptides, which are then secreted into the blood, and then they get to the gastrointestinal tract that way. Okay. Hi. So when you look at the brain-body connection over here, that's what I'm talking about, the autonomic nervous system and the neurohormones. When we talking about the digestive system, I'm going to stick with convention, but become confused by technology. Sorry, here we are. The digestive system, we've got to talk about the alimentary canal. And everybody is hopefully familiar with the alimentary canal and the parts of the alimentary canal. But I'm going to talk particularly about oesophagitis and upper gastrointestinal problems and peptic ulceration. Talk about irritable bowel syndrome. Talk about cancer and bowel, large bowel problems. And try and connect each of those with the brain and the mind. I'm also going to talk about the liver and the pancreas as part of the digestive system. All right, sorry. Well, we look at the mind, which I'm going to explore quite a bit at the end of the lecture, last half hour or so. We can talk about perceptions, emotions, memories, attitudes, instincts, ideas, concepts, and beliefs. Right? And we can also look at which aspects of the mind are conscious and which are unconscious and which are subconscious. Now, a lot of the people like Freud, who wrote about divisions in conscious and unconscious, divided it just between conscious and unconscious. I think that it's useful to recognize things that are subconscious, even though the two may be a little bit blurred at times. For example, some of the aspects of the way the brain affects the digestive system are truly unconscious most of the time. Even if you try to become aware of them, you can't become aware of them. For example, where the peristalsis is occurring in your gut, it's very difficult to be aware. I don't know anyone that maybe in very strange or unusual situations, people can be aware of it, but most often you're not aware of it. Whereas some aspects of things that are usually not conscious, one can become aware of if one consciously directs one's mind at it. But the conscious aspects of one's mind obviously affect the subconscious aspects as well. So, things like instincts I would consider to be more unconscious or subconscious things. They're drives and motivations that are there in everyone, but they express differently depending on what people's attitudes, what their experiences are, etc. Their will. Looking at the connection between the brain and the digestive system, and how the brain affects the digestive system. There is a problem with being too reductionist in connecting one little bit of the brain with one particular function. For example, things like emotional reactions, even though they will say that it's involves the limbic system, the complex emotional reactions obviously involve lots of other areas of the brain as well. We know that, the visual cortex is involved in vision, but obviously vision stimulates emotional reactions, so it must involve circuits involving the limbic system as well. So I think it's useful to look at really a collection of interconnecting circuits. And those circuits keep on forming between different areas of the brain and keep on happening and forming right throughout life. That's something we talked about last time, and I think that this has a bearing on really all our preventive medicine strategies, as well as how we can improve brain function and health at the same time. Now, the cortex obviously is involved to some degree in beliefs, physical activities, attitudes, perceptions. The midbrain, I'm referring to the area of the brain when you take away the hemispheres and above the brain stem. And that is includes the limbic system and the basal ganglia and the thalamus, the pituitary, and the pineal. these areas are particularly involved with emotional reactions, and it's obvious that emotions affect the autonomic nervous system and therefore affect physiology in lots of ways, including the digestive system. And then the brainstem is also involved in autonomic regulation of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. So the autonomic nervous system is influenced by the brainstem and the midbrain. So you've got the emotional centers, the limbic system over there underneath the temporal lobes, and then obviously different connections, different areas of the brain. Now, most of the, when you look at the effects on the gastrointestinal tract, while there is an effect obviously from the brain, there are also various internal mechanisms within the gastrointestinal tract. For example, if you eat a meal with a lot of protein, the stomach will produce more hydrochloric acid, okay, more pepsin. Similarly, the gut, the peristalsis, will partly be a reaction to the actually bulk within the gut itself. So even though you've got this external influence from the brain coming down, regulating the contractility of the gut muscles, part of the function of the gut is actually determined by local mechanical factors and local chemical factors. Does that make sense? The main connection, as I said, is the autonomic nervous system. And the sympathetic nervous system, which is involved in fight or flight reflex, tends to divert activity away from the gut and the digestive activity. It increases blood flow to the periphery, to the muscles, etc., and decreases intestinal gastric motility, contracts sphincters, and inhibits glandular secretion. The parasympathetic nervous system is more involved in rest and digest activity, and that tends to increase motility and relax sphincters and stimulate glandular secretion. Now, there's a problem that will arise from this in trying to understand if sympathetic stimulation decreases glandular secretion. Why does it cause, why does stress cause ulcers? Does stress cause ulcers? Does everybody think that stress causes ulcers? Or can? It can, it's a factor at least. Yeah. Any theories as to why?
Does it decrease the stress? Sympathetic doesn't affect the gastric secretion or the acid, doesn't sympathetic increase the acid secretion?
That is one possibility. They're not certain whether it actually inhibits. They know that parasympathetic stimulation does increase acid secretion. Sympathetic stimulation may increase secretion, may decrease secretion, but one thing that it will do is decrease mucus secretion. So it may be just a decrease in the protective effect of the mucus.
That becomes dry, therefore your gastric secretions dry up too?
Well, it does decrease. Sympathetic stimulation will decrease the secretions, yeah. There is another interesting connection which I'll expand on a little bit more. I've been reading Pavlov. That's right, everybody knows about Pavlov's dogs. This is called Psychopathology and Psychiatry by Pavlov. I didn't know he had written anything on psychopathology and psychiatry. But I'm actually, there is not that much about psychiatry in it, but there's lots about dogs. Right, and lots about the salivation of dogs, and it's quite interesting. So he did absolutely terrible things to dogs, like I have to establish that. But at the same time, it did cast some light on what we're talking about today, right? And one of the things is, of course, you know that he got dogs to salivate by ringing bells and conditioning the response, right? But the initial salivation was based on a natural response of salivation to food, right? So he made an association between the bell and the food, and therefore the bell started causing the salivation. One of the other things that he did, though, is introduce sand into these dogs, which is strapped into these harnesses, which is sort of pretty much what they were doing. But they were putting sand into the dog's mouth, or acid, hydrochloric acid, right, and finding that that caused also salivation. But it was causing salivation to increase, to detoxify, basically, be able to expel the sand. Right. Later on, though, they found that just presenting the sight of the sand caused the salivation. Right. So one of the things that acid does in the stomach is actually breaks down toxins. Okay, breaks down poisons. So it's quite possible that people who are seeing things that could be, as I mentioned last time, things that are audiovisual toxins, could be creating a physiological response of increasing acid production. These sort of things, when you read the sort of stuff that Pavlov's experiments did demonstrate, it really does open a lot of different possibilities regarding how the mind can affect the body through, I suppose, confused signals based on normal physiological responses, you know, or physiological responses that developed because of real toxins that are there, but we are interpreting them differently. Yeah. So what does the mind influence? Dietary habits and behavior, taste and smell, which then become important just for well-being in itself, but also stimulation of eating and appetite, secretion of glands, which you mentioned before, motility of the alimentary tract, activity of the sphincters, and perhaps absorption of nutrients. If you think that secretion of glands and motility of the alimentary tract will themselves affect absorption of nutrients. But it's possible that there are other things that occur. For example, you'll recognize that people who have a low level of salt will get a craving for salty foods at particular times. Similarly, the body may be recognizing different needs in different ways and selectively absorbing some substances more than others. Yeah. I think could be looked at in terms of research. And the other thing is, of course, mind affects immune activity. And when I'm talking about cancer of the bowel as well as inflammatory bowel disease, we'll look at some of the ways in which immune activity or the mind affecting immune activity can affect these diseases. So, some of the common illnesses influenced by the mental activity include obesity and anorexia, which are influenced by dietary habits particularly. Gastroesophageal reflux and peptic ulceration, and irritable bowel syndrome, which most people will accept is at least affected by stress. And the last two, second last two, malignancy and inflammatory bowel disease, which are affected by effects on the immune system. And of course, diabetes, which is really an endocrine problem, I suppose. I am going to talk a little bit about it if I have enough time. And there are factors that affect diabetes, and there are psychological factors. specifically some of the mental effects on diet and dietary habits influences the choice of foods, likes and dislikes, drinking habits, including, of course, coffee, tea, and alcohol, and Coca-Cola, and a whole range of other things which can cause digestive problems, particularly in terms of reflux. Beliefs regarding nutrition and health shape people's choice regarding foods, and there's a lot of confusion out there as to what healthy food is and what a healthy diet is. And later on, we'll try in the course of the others, as well as what a healthy mind is, and not so easy. Also, beliefs regarding harmful food, which can include things that are genuinely harmful and things that people are just worried about. And there are more and more things that people are worried about as well. Some with good, some with bad reason. And also self-image affects dietary habits, which we'll talk about, particularly in terms of anorexia. Specifically looking at the way beliefs can affect diet and dietary habits. A lot of people have preconceptions about food that are either nice or that are healthy, and they're sometimes quite difficult to shake and sometimes are reinforced in various ways by the advertising industry or whatever that are selling particular ideas. People also tend to eat familiar foods, things that they have either been brought up with or they used to. But there's an attraction for new food, new preparations of food, etc. And I think that's quite important to focus on. A lot of the focus that we give dietary-wise tends to be telling people what they shouldn't eat. Certainly that is pushed in terms of our education. And I think it's important to be able to encourage people to broaden their diet, learn to cook different preparations of spinach, or you know, eat raw spinach, or eating raw vegetables, encouraging a broad variety. And it's helpful if one knows oneself how to prepare food and have an awareness of that, so that you can talk about it with some enthusiasm. Also, people tend to limit, as I said, harmful foods. People's preconceptions and their habits also influence the regularity of their meals and the size of their meals. That can be one factor in people developing middle-aged spread and becoming overweight as they become older, because obviously your energy requirements decrease as you become older. If you continue eating the same sized meals at the same time, you're very likely to become overweight. And the other one is cooking and presentation of foods, which I think is becoming more and more recognized as being quite important, and eating environments. For thousands of years, people considered eating to be a very important social activity, very good for families. And these are some of the things that are being a little bit lost with our fast food culture. Talk about obesity and anorexia. Some of the things that I thought seemed logically to be factors in development of obesity. Food preferences for fattening foods and drinks. It's so hard to counter the influence of television in that. You know, really, they use all the hypnotic tricks that are possible to get you to crave the food. Have you seen these new ads for those shapes saying "eat me" or whatever it is? And I'm not aware of this ad. Maybe I've been. They play it during Seinfeld. The only thing I have been watching recently. Get a dose of reality. Too many meals can be a problem. People are brought up with the idea of eating three meals a day. It might be heresy, but I don't think three meals a day are necessarily necessary. I don't eat three meals a day. And I think it might be, it's important to eat at a balanced diet, but as to when exactly you eat that balanced diet and how you eat it, I mean, traditionally hunter-gatherer societies who have certainly a very low incidence of a lot of the problems that we get now in terms of heart disease didn't eat three meals a day.
Yeah. Didn't have the food to do it.
Didn't have the food to do it. But there's also, if you look at other primates, obviously they eat as they're going along. You know, there are, I don't know, I know that eating a big meal, great big meal at the end of the evening really doesn't seem to make a lot of logical sense in terms of our energy utilization.
So how many meals would you recommend?
How many? If I may be mysterious and mention the Zen saying of eating when you're hungry and sleeping when you're sleepy, I think that is quite a reasonable principle. I do that. I eat when I'm hungry and asleep. Eating regularly is important, but necessarily eating three meals a day or eating, I think different people have to understand their own needs. Other things to do with factors in obesity or psychological factors is, of course, lack of physical exercise, lack of mental activity. They say that 25% of our energy is burnt up by our brain. And if so, it is a way that people can lose weight as well by increasing the amount of mental activity that they're doing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right, yeah.
I feel hungry all the time, and I become quite excited. For me, it's just terrible.
Yeah, it needs the physical activity as well. I don't think that completely even just sort of sitting there thinking about the activity is quite the same. But I have read that they did some studies a while back showing that when you think about a particular activity, if you're just lying there and think about running, you are getting slight contractions in all those muscles. Absolutely. Yeah, it is. It's exercising very much the easy way. Yeah, it is documented that that is the case. But it is also, but I think that that's actually can be used, I'm sure it has been used, in fact, in terms of calisthenics and things where they do use that as an exercise for muscles, but I think it needs to be accompanied with actual physical movement as well. Yeah. Another psychological factor that I think is important in obesity is negative preconceptions about particular foods. A lot of people are brought up with the idea that fresh veggies and greens are not nice. Maybe they were forced to eat them when they were younger. But I've met quite a few people who will say, I don't like vegetables. People who are overweight and trying to treat the weight problem, who have got a whole lot of ideas about things that they have not either ever eaten or maybe ate years and years ago, and who knows how it was cooked. It might have just been boiled into mush and they've decided that they didn't like it. That's where I think it's important to be introducing ideas about cooking and presentation of foods and the fact that the same food can be prepared in different ways. And also breaking down preconceptions that if a food tastes nice, it can't be good for you and things like that. I don't think they're helpful. And a lot of people do believe these cliches. All right. Some of the known risks with obesity, I'm sure everybody will be familiar with, ischemic heart disease, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, osteoarthritis, and also depression and unhappiness. I think the myth that people who are overweight are happy, or the fat jolly stereotype, is not true. I think obesity can cause depression, but of course depression can also cause obesity, which is showing what I was saying about these two-way connections. Of course no. There are also factors to do with one's self-image and confidence relating to one's weight. There are people, obviously, when you're talking about things like conditions like anorexia nervosa and bulimia, people who are not overweight develop ideas and loss of confidence in their self-image, thinking that they're overweight. So one does have to have realistic ideas about what a healthy weight is, and perhaps at the same time, if one is slightly overweight, not being worried about that. Is that, that's what you mean?
Yes, but still you've got people like Friar Tuxen as well.
Yeah.
And he was presented as a jolly sort of person, and I'm sure there are some fat people who are quite happy in their roly polies.
I'm sure there are people, there might even people, I'm sure there are in fact people who actually like the fact that they're fat and actually try and become fatter. But at the same time, I don't think one can deny the health risks to a person like that.
Not everyone loses fat is unhappy.
Of course not, no, no. And not... Absolutely. You can get people who are carrying more weight than average, or even to a point where they are carrying a lot of extra weight, or have a lot of fat tissue. Obviously, is not necessarily a reflection on the person's level of fitness. So you can get people who are overweight who are very fit, and you can get people who are underweight or slim or normal weight or whatever. However, these things are defined, which is pretty much, I mean, there is a problem with looking at everything like a bell curve, you know, that that's the normal and that's abnormal, too high and that's too low.
Yeah. Have a high body mass index, that.
Some psychotherapeutic objectives for the treatment of obesity. Trying to focus on some positive suggestions rather than restrictions, even though I think some restrictions are obviously necessary. Broadening the taste regarding non-fattening foods, I think, is important, as well as enjoyment of non-fattening foods. Eating raw vegetables, I think, is wonderful. I've only discovered it late in life. Maybe that's why I'm such an enthusiast of them. I had preconceptions about things like celery, and eating celery, and sometimes, you know, that adults have acquired tastes. I mean, there are lots of things that are acquired tastes, and people can consciously acquire a taste for something if they want to do it. And it's just a matter of starting somewhere and building up each day or each week to try, every time you go to the market, try and buy a new type of green or vegetable. We're very fortunate in Melbourne to have a huge range of different foodstuffs that we can choose from in terms of nuts and cereals and fresh fruits and vegetables. And very often people are still tied in with what their family ate or what has been introduced to them or from the television set or whatever. And I think doctors are a very good source of presenting this information, and very often we ourselves aren't thinking very much in terms of that to introduce it to their ideas. Yeah. The other thing is changing attitude regarding healthy foods, which are affected by the negative preconceptions. That's what I was saying, that if it tastes good, it can't be good for you, that cliche, and trying to break that down. Also increasing confidence regarding ability to achieve weight loss, assuming, of course, that weight loss is necessary, and also letting them be aware that fitness is not exercise and activity is useful for fitness quite independent of weight. So it's worthwhile people going for a walk or going for a swim just to become more fit, regardless of whether they lose weight or not, and also that they can replace fat with muscle, so they don't necessarily need have weight loss to actually improve their health. And increasing enthusiasm for physical activity, I think, is important to be consciously aware of that, because some people approach exercise as if it is a punishment. You know, they really think that they've done their exercise, and that is not likely to be something that they will maintain as a long-term behavior change. Yeah. Talking about anorexia, I don't know if anybody read the Age, I think it was last weekend or the weekend before, yeah? There was an article. They were talking, the British Medical Association particularly commented on the media and advertising industry, and there were some of these people from the fashion industry and magazines, etc., explaining that it was the public that really wanted the thin images, etc. But the thing I... even though the British Medical Association are talking about it and drawing attention to it now, of course there have been people talking about the connection between anorexia and very thin stereotypes and ideals, fashion images, back from the time of Twiggy in the 1960s. And it's good. It's a bit belated that the medical profession is recognizing it as being as serious a problem as it is. But at the same time that very thin fashions have been pushed in more and more different areas, anorexia has become a problem not only of young girls. If you read the 1980s textbooks, they basically said it was just young women who had it. Now there are a significant number of young boys who also have anorexia and bulimia. And of course, there's a significant number of people who still die by starving themselves. So there are lots of theories regarding the causation of anorexia nervosa, and I think that a lot of them explain part of the reason. And trying to develop an integrative approach, I think, is important, and it's also important to have a holistic perspective on it, to basically look at the whole thing and try and look at all the different factors that are influencing each individual person who comes to see you. And some of the things that may be involved include self-image, concepts regarding ideal weight, and concepts regarding ideal body shape, which are not necessarily the same, of course. That some girls will starve themselves because they've got broad hips, right? And regardless of them being very underweight or very, they still have a perception that they are overweight or fat because they've got broad hips. You're smiling? Yeah.
So you've got broad bones, it's not much you can do about it by losing weight.
Exactly. Well, that's the tragedy of it. and that's really what the British Medical Association is saying, that what is presented as an ideal is so far away from anything, from really any shape that a lot of women could ever achieve under any circumstances, because it's to do with people's bone structure, etc. And of course, fear of obesity then becomes a problem, that people are afraid of becoming overweight, and perhaps their definition of what obesity is comes down as well. So they start thinking that even when they are not overweight, that they are overweight. At the same time, they've done quite a few studies to show that a significant number of people who, by medical standards, are overweight don't consider themselves to be overweight, particularly young and middle-aged men in Australia, which they did the study. They don't consider themselves to be overweight, even though they were considered to be moderately obese according to, you know, body mass index type analysis of it. Unhappiness, of course, is a factor in anorexia. There are a lot of girls who will starve themselves. At least it's a feature that is there. I don't think anybody would deny that a lot of girls with anorexia are unhappy. But part of that can be a cause of the unhappiness, and it can be partly a result of the anorexia. And also a result of the treatment of the anorexia, which is pretty horrible. If you've seen, you know, some of the you know, girls in the hospitals who have been nasogastrically fed for a year, you know, it's not a good thing for a person's you know, social life or their life generally. Yeah. And fear of adulthood, that's the psychoanalytical theory that has been thrown around. I see a certain amount of logic in that in some situations. And I've certainly seen some women with anorexia who have seemed to be afraid of the growing up and the changes associated with growing up. There are, of course, connections with girls who have been sexually abused, etc., having a higher risk of anorexia. And that may be associated with this fear of adulthood. So it might be particularly that subgroup of people who have got anorexia. The other thing is fear of food or fear of particular foods, often because they're afraid that the food will cause weight gain or something along those lines.
censorship will get anorexia. Teenagers get anorexia, what's the percentage? 5%?
Nothing. Sorry?
What's the percentage?
Yeah, yeah. Sorry?
20.
20% of teenagers are dealing with anorexia or bulimia. And what you can find is when they are bulimic, they are very keen to be anorexic. Something what is just one two sides of the same coin.
I wouldn't agree with that. The figure that was quoted in the story in The Age when they were talking about it, I think firstly one has to separate anorexia from anorexia nervosa, which is certainly should be only limited to a much more severe situation where a person is actually clinically is actually starving themselves and developing physiological problems from the starvation. And that, I think, probably affects about 1 in 200 girls, and that's the estimate that they give. 1 in 200 or 1 in 100 get diagnosed as having anorexia nervosa, which is still a massive number of people, girls worldwide. And of course, it is a problem of developed countries. It is spreading to other countries, but it was never described in the past. And the figure of the 1 in 5, I think there was. They did mention this figure of 1 in 5 people have some degree of bulimic symptoms, right? Or bulimic activity, you might even describe it as, which are things like, vomiting binge after a binge. I've known a number of people who are, doctors and nurses and all sorts of medical professional people who, after having a big binge, vomited. And have done it. I think a lot of people did. The Romans did it. They weren't diagnosed as.
Because they keep on eating another course. It's part of their thing.
That's right. Courses. Yeah, yeah. But all I'm saying is that I think that bulimic behavior, or like what you might consider to be unhealthy things that people do when they're relating to their eating, is quite different from a person who develops a real problem with their nutrition, a serious problem with their nutrition, like anorexia. Problem with the term anorexia is it's associated with a very high mortality, etc., and a long-term problem. The more we broaden, if you look at the criteria for diagnosis of anorexia, you've got a checklist, for example, 20% of weight loss in such and such a period of time and other associated symptoms. So you're necessarily, there's going to be a mixed range of causes as to why those people are starving themselves. So I think it's important that when we use these terms like anorexia, especially anorexia nervosa, that it doesn't just become a label, because it's not really an explanation. It's a description, but not really an explanation. I was going back looking at some of the explanations, the theoretical explanations in Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine back from 1980, and they gave three different schools of thought. And one school of thought was that it was related to images, and the self-image, etc. Another school of thought was that it was related to over-controlling parents and a desire to establish control, etc. And another school of thought it had something to do with the satiety center in the hypothalamus. Right. To me, there's such a problem in looking at these as separate schools of thought, as if there's any way of understanding anorexia without integrating all of those together and finding out which factors. And I think they missed out on a lot of other factors as well by limiting themselves within the school of thought. But looking generally, when I'm talking about anorexia, I suppose I'm talking about situations where people are starving themselves. Some of the problems that can happen, of course, milder levels of just fatigue and weakness. Also symptoms of more serious malnutrition. Menstrual irregularity, which demonstrates the influence on the hormonal system of our nutrition, and also vitamin deficiencies, neurological problems, cardiovascular problems. Well, protein malnutrition can also cause neurological problems as well as vitamin things, plus various elements as well, trace elements. Deficiency can cause neurological problems. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Some of the psychotherapeutic objectives in the treatment, just general points, include identifying the cause of the anorexia, as I said, which requires one obviously to sit down and talk to the person who's and listen and find out what the problems are. Increasing self-esteem is a general principle that it's usually important. Educating regarding healthy dietary habits. Broadening taste regarding food. Not so much focusing on fattening foods, but healthy foods in a balance. And encouraging social activities and friendships, which I think is very important, also for the increasing self-esteem. And the other thing is regular exercise without over-exercising. There's been a little bit, I think it was on television recently, I didn't watch it myself, but some warnings regarding over-exercising and people who are exercise fanatics. And this can be a problem, and it can also be a problem when people over-exercise for weight reduction, as you know. Right. Well, we'll leave the dietary, obesity and anorexia, and move on to the esophagus. Has anybody will go through the esophagus? Okay, well, we'll talk about stomach and esophagitis. Stomach and esophagus. Is everybody happy, or not happy about it, but everybody agree that anxiety can trigger, or worry can trigger esophagitis, or aggravate esophagitis?
Yeah.
Any theories on why? Sorry?
I said it happened to me this week.
It happened to you this week. Two particular factors, or three, include the protective aspects, acid refluxing, and the patency of the gastroesophageal valve. And I find this quite, just drawing a little diagram, quite a useful thing to explain to patients as to why particularly coffee and alcohol and cigarette smoking cause reflux. It's one of those conditions where a mechanistic explanation is actually quite helpful, because I think there are really quite obvious mechanical factors involved in esophagitis. And we know that coffee, alcohol, and I think it's the actual caffeine in that, so Coca-Cola also does it. And that causes weakness in the valve, and so acid can reflux into the lower esophagus and cause burning. Obviously, other things that increase intra-abdominal pressure will also increase reflux. So people's activities have a bearing on the development of esophagitis, but also symptoms. And quite often, just looking at addressing the psychological causes, if you look at it broadly in terms of mental stress, eating habits, dietary habits, posture and activities, and you don't need any H2 blockers. Yeah. Obviously, they're very effective. If you need to treat esophagitis with drugs, there are good drugs to use for it. But most often, I think esophagitis can be managed with dietary and behavioral change. Yeah. Plus propping up the head end of the bed, etc. Yeah. And these some of the psychological factors involved in peptic ulceration: stress, anxiety, worry, irritation. Most importantly, drug-taking habits and beliefs. I think most of the ulcers in our society are actually caused by non-steroidal anti-inflammatories and other drugs that cause peptic ulceration. Another reason why it's important to maintain a holistic approach to one's own health as well, that if one learns to walk and move when one is young and keeps flexible, the likelihood of needing to take non-steroidal anti-inflammatories and subsequently develop a peptic ulcer decreases. We were talking about peptic ulceration, so I shall... that's upside down. That's the stomach, cross-section of the stomach, which... You can see some of the ways in which the mind affects the stomach. Going from the peritoneal cavity in obviously affects the smooth muscle which goes through the bowel involving the peristaltic activity. Okay, so there is transverse and longitudinal smooth muscle. These are then affected by branches of the vagus nerve, in particular parasympathetic branches, and also influenced by sympathetic nervous system. And there are layers of neurons within the bowel itself, and these affect the smooth muscle, but also affect glandular secretion by the parietal cells and the goblet cells, which are secreting mucus and also secreting enzymes and acid. Okay, so but then the gut also has signals coming from the brain and from other endocrine organs via the bloodstream. Yeah, sorry, are you amused by the stomach? All right. A couple of hours. I enjoyed this one. It was fun because it's all little bits.
It reminds me of the Richard Scarry books. I don't know whether anyone's read the Richard Scarry books for their kids.
So, okay, you've got the blood flow carrying messages from the brain, including things like adrenaline, biogenic amines. Now, one of the things that I... when you look at the way that autonomic nervous system or emotional imbalances can affect the bowel, causing spasm in the bowel, as well as, say, problems, motility problems. So you can also get dysphagia just caused by motility problems in the esophagus. It's worthwhile looking at the balance, relative balance between sympathetic and parasympathetic activity. Okay, but also the sympathetic nervous adrenaline and the other catecholamines tend to increase smooth muscle sensitivity. So you might be more likely to develop spasm as a result of parasympathetic or sympathetic activity when you've already got more circulating amines. I'll leave the stomach. I'll come back to the stomach in a moment when we talk about just reducing anxiety. But we'll also talk about the liver. liver to common problems relating to the liver are caused by very clearly unhealthy habits. And I think those would probably be the commonest causes of liver disease. And when I was looking through and trying to sort of integrate and digest all these digestive system problems, I was struck by the number of digestive problems that are caused by environmental and psychological factors. Things that can be changed, in other words, and things that can be prevented. There are not many of them. I mean, there are, of course, hereditary and genetic digestive problems, but a lot of the common problems that we're talking about are things that can be quite readily avoided. And we can provide good advice about how to avoid those problems, as well as how to treat them if a person does have it. But when you're talking about alcoholic cirrhosis, or hepatitis, there isn't really any cure, so our efforts should be aimed towards prevention. And I'll talk a little bit about unhealthy habits and ways that we can think some of the things that can contribute to unhealthy habits and some of the ways that we can deal with it and psychologically, which then have a bearing on both these problems. Of course, viral hepatitis is particularly related to IV drug use. And intravenous injections can obviously introduce the toxin itself and damage from the toxin or from infective agents, including hepatitis or from HIV. And the actual risk of infection, and even though I think that there are problems with being too fear-oriented in preventive medicine, I think it is a very valid thing to point out the risk of infection as a motivating tool to stop people from injecting drugs. I think if people are aware of the very big difference between injecting a drug and ingesting it, and are consciously aware of that from the time that they're little children, I think that it is a big step. Even though people will make much of a person who starts off smoking cannabis or smoking heroin going on to injecting, I think it's actually a small number of people who actually go on to injecting. There are lots of barriers to injecting, but I'm seeing these barriers being progressively broken down as people become less and less sensitized to the idea that basically they become desensitized to the idea of self-injection, and it starts being put forward as part of modern society and something that's inevitable in society. And I don't think it is. I think it is something that really was only introduced 100 years ago or something along those lines. It wasn't long ago, maybe 150 years was the first time that we ever did any sort of intravenous injections. It was introduced to the world by the medical profession, and I think the medical profession have some responsibility to be really trying to come up with some solution to try and get rid of the problem. So I don't see it as the same thing as, say, people smoking, because it's something that people have done for thousands of years. It's the same thing with drinking alcohol, whereas I do see injection, self-injection of drugs is a very different thing. Yeah. Looking at some of the psychotherapeutic principles for reduction of anxiety, this is of course useful for oesophagitis or for peptic ulceration or for irritable bowel syndrome. Improving communication and sociability, increased optimism. When we talk about the second one, we're talking about the future. Fearful imaginings, we're talking about the past, the present, and the future. And this fourth one is relating to the past. So I think trying to get that balance of what people are looking at relating to the past, the present, and the future, all three have to be addressed if we're truly to get rid of a person's anxiety and for them to identify the source of the anxiety. In a sense, we can't get rid of anybody's anxiety. What we can do is give them some tools for them to be able to identify the sources themselves and do something about it. Because increased enjoyment in life and pleasurable activities, and improved efficiency and time management. So reading an article that was identifying it that the medical profession, and that includes other professions that are related to the medical profession, have a high incidence of depression. And this, one of the big factors that they identified was stress regarding time. And I think we have much more demands on time management than we had traditionally. It's something that all of us have been brought up with and we are still battling with. And the other thing is development of new skills and abilities. I think that is a very important thing for reducing anxiety and also building self-esteem. And there is no limit to people's, in terms of age, towards developing new skills. There are limits in terms of how quickly new skills can be developed, but I think that there are always possibilities in every different area. And I think that has a bearing on what I was talking about last time, about developing the brain, developing more different connections, and the connections with our movement, with our activities, with our fine dexterity, with our speaking, our singing, and all those different things that human beings can do. And I think that that is a good, at least a step in the right direction to preventing dementia. And I think that if we focus on those things, we can prevent dementia. I'm counting on it. Looking at specific psychotherapy for unhealthy habits, I'll just make a few quick points, which are, a lot of these things are very obvious. One thing, though, is audiovisual triggers. I think that is really quite important to add, to address, and it's very difficult to address because the amount of advertising of alcohol that's on television or wherever is very difficult to avoid, and these are very big stimulants for people to start indulging in whatever the behavior is. And I've been increasingly, I've seen a number of recent reports in the newspapers about heroin addiction and heroin use, showing people injecting, shooting up on the front page of the newspaper. I don't think that's a good idea, and I think a significant number of people will just see the syringe and they will go and inject. And that's how automatically these kind of associations happen. And I think the more people see images of syringes here and there, the more likely some people who are susceptible to that will be that they will be injecting. That's what I talked about, the desensitization of our society. If people saw this as a very peculiar plastic implement with a needle that you put inside your arm, people, which is really a more natural way of looking at it, I don't think children would inject. But when they're seeing it as just something that people do when they grow up, you know, then of course they're more likely to do it. Yeah. Talk a little bit about mind and intestines. We haven't got that much time, so I'll go through a little bit quicker. Disorders of motility, we talked a little bit about, irritable bowel syndrome, and constipation, nervous diarrhea. As I said, obviously the motility of the gut is partly influenced by our thinking, but it's also influenced by the actual contents of the gut itself, and that's where I was talking about, I think, the bark and the fiber within food. Again, the evidence is, I think, in the direction that getting that fiber from the skin of vegetables and from the husk of cereals and from nuts, etc., is much more healthy than trying to get it from fiber gel, you know, from some sort of preparation like that, apart from the influence of the benefit from one's teeth. Yeah. Then you've got inflammatory bowel disease, ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, and malignancies, which are influenced by the immune system generally. So I'll quickly go on to that. And of course, the immune system affects infections and likelihood of developing infections. The mind can adversely affect intestinal health by affecting eating and drinking behavior, of course, and then via the autonomic nervous system and, as I mentioned, immune system. Some of the psychotherapeutic principles for irritable bowel syndrome. Yeah. Lessen anxiety, especially with dreaded events. I think people will be, a lot of people who have not, wouldn't consider themselves to have irritable bowel syndrome will be familiar with getting the runs before they get worried about something, you know. And increasing activities associated with emotional tranquility includes things like music. The word meditation I just used to describe contemplation and quiet contemplative thought time. And increasing dietary fiber from vegetables, fruits, cereals, which I think needs to be done gradually. If you suddenly increase dietary fiber, you can start getting pain from that, problems from that. And increasing activities involving postural change. I think the physical and mechanical aspects of the digestive system are such that posture has quite a big bearing on the digestive function. And I think people who are constipated, just explaining to them to spend a bit of time squatting down, it's so simple and it's so effective to actually stimulate their bowel bowels to move. This is the intestine, which is back to front. And you can see the same sort of layers as in the stomach and throughout the digestive tract. The autonomic nervous system has an influence on the smooth muscle there. And then also affects the villi through the secretion of the enzymes and mucus of the villus, and the villus itself is moving as well, and that is affected by the autonomic nervous system as well. Right, some of the factors in inflammatory bowel disease. I'm just going to talk about some of the immunological ways that the mind can affect the bowel. One thing is to do with autoimmune disease generally. It's been thought that negative thinking or negative aspects of thinking towards oneself could have an effect on development of autoantibodies. I mentioned that as a possibility last time. We do know, I mean, I could see this anecdotally in certainly patients who've had rheumatoid arthritis over the years. People with problems with self-confidence, I've noticed, and associations are very anecdotal. I don't know how many studies have been done along those lines, but certainly they have associated development of autoimmune disease with particular stressful events. And I've known quite a few people who had developed different autoimmune problems after having specific stresses. It just seems logical to me that self-directed immune activity could be influenced to some degree by perception of the self, an image of oneself, or perhaps what one didn't like in oneself, etc. There's just things to think about. Certainly aggravating factors, stress in the form of anxiety, irritability, jealousy, all the different things that can cause stress, can affect inflammatory bowel disease when it's established and make it worse. The other thing when you're talking about specific psychoimmunological principles is, could fear of cancer increase the risk of cancer? Does anybody think that that's possible? Yeah. I can see mechanisms how that could happen. If that is the case, we've got really big problems with the way we're approaching preventive medicine, because there's a lot of stuff that happens that increases people's fear of cancer. Another point that I'd make on the same point is that if a person develops breast cancer and has a mother or another family member with breast cancer, she will go down as part of the statistics saying that there's a genetic link. She'll become part of the genetic statistics, you could say, the gene statistics. But of course, if she has got a fear of cancer because her mother has got cancer and that has increased her risk of developing breast cancer or whatever the cancer may be, you will find that any effect that does exist of a psychoimmunological nature like that relating to fear will be attributed automatically, according to our current paradigm, to a gene cause, and that could be quite misleading. Right? So these things could actually be sorted out with careful twin studies. If they really looked at adoption studies and twin studies, they would be able to identify such a factor influencing the development of cancer generally. And I think it's quite an important thing that we need to do, or needs to be done. Yeah. that is the top one that I was mentioning there, fear of cancer. See, with ulcerative colitis, patients will routinely be told that they have a very high risk of developing carcinoma of the bowel. Now, if that can increase the risk of carcinoma of the bowel, it's a problem. At the same time, one wouldn't want to not alert a person to the early symptoms of carcinoma of the bowel. So it is a fine tightrope that we have to walk down as doctors. Because that's the second point, which is a fear of doctors can lead to delay in diagnosis of carcinoma of the bowel. So I think people do need to know generally that fear of the bowel can be cured surgically very often. So that's one of the difficulties. And of course, the mind has an effect on recovery after surgery as well as perhaps the risk of recurrence. Again, you can see how important sorting out that question of whether or not a fear of cancer can cause cancer. If, I mean, there were at least 50% of the people here think that it is a possibility. Now, if it is a possibility, it is such an important possibility, we really need to sort that out, because when you're looking at risk of recurrence, one of the routine things that we do is try and make people aware of, they become more aware of the cancer. Our treatments generally make people more aware of it. Yeah. All right. I'm not going to get to talk about diabetes to any degree. Yeah. Sure.
Enable them to know that there are a lot of things that they can actually do.
Absolutely.
And I think that tends to alleviate
the fear. Sure.
Maybe that's not addressed enough.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I think that's very important, that I think a pessimistic prognosis is a death sentence, so it can be a death sentence. And giving people hope and realizing oneself that there is reason for hope, regardless of how bad the cancer is, there are still, firstly, examples of people who have had regressions of cancers. That is difficult because you can't give people false hope either. But I mean, it's something like bowel cancer, it's not that much of a problem, because bowel cancer can so easily be treated, or quite often be treated. I agree with you completely. Yeah, people have to. But how do you deal with telling a person that they have a cancer, say a kind of cancer of the pancreas or something along those lines, which is incurable, or you think to be incurable? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, looking very briefly at the mind and pancreas, sympathetic nervous system stimulation caused decreased exocrine secretion and decreased insulin secretion, which causes a raise in blood sugar. So that's an obvious reason why stress can increase hyperglycemia. We'll skim through diabetes, but obviously the mind is influenced in autoimmune factors. Type 1 diabetes, if it does have a role in autoimmunity. And obviously the mind has an influence in type 2 diabetes, especially if it's associated with being overweight, but also insulin resistance is affected by people's activity levels. And that is influenced by one's mind. And regardless of whether it's type 1 or type 2, stress and anxiety will raise blood sugar and can cause it more fluctuations in blood sugar. What is a healthy diet? This is my idea what a healthy diet is, okay? Now I have some qualifications on that. They're only principles, sort of vague, broader principles. But if that's not enough, is there anything that you consider, anyone consider to be unhealthy in there? Have I? Ah, that's a different.
It's very difficult to consume every day these fresh veggies and all that, when you can't have protein or fish twice a week and everything. Just, you know, it's whole job. It's like your second shift. You cook every time.
Sure.
You can't be stressful enough to
right.
get cancer.
Well,
I
think.
In order to follow this product.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, but I mean, these are, it's to do with a perspective of what one considers to be the most important things to be pursuing in life. You know, like, you can have a basic awareness. I think having an awareness of what a healthy diet is quite different from being obsessional about trying to achieve a healthy diet all the time because you're worried about getting sick in 20 years' time or whatever the case may be. Some people do. I think if people go down that road of becoming very worried about what they're eating, that itself becomes a health problem, and it's not an unusual health problem. So I think that a healthy diet involves more than just the diet. It also includes healthy dietary habits, which again might be very difficult to achieve, but they're an ideal, just things that I think need to be remembered. Eating for need rather than greed. Again, it's not an easy thing to necessarily tell patients. At the same time, if one doesn't have any awareness that that person might be overeating and you don't want to touch on the subject in case you offend the patient, you're actually going to miss out on very important advice that person might need. So I think tact is one of the things that we have to learn, is to be able to tell people things in a tactful way. And I think that one can broaden the diet, one's diet in healthy foods. You know, it doesn't, it's not that much of a challenge. It's quite an enjoyable thing to do. Just improving one's diet. It's different from suddenly wanting to have an ideal diet, as opposed to the idea that every day or every week that you can continue moving in more direction of health regarding one's diet. But that's, as a, looking at some general objectives of psychotherapy, one has to recognize that the mind, obviously, we are more than we eat. Yeah, and there are lots of different aspects of what one might hope for in trying to achieve when one is giving someone some sort of counseling or advice generally. And the bottom to subjective feelings of health and objective improvements of health. Of course, if a person has cancer and you're able to convince them that they don't have cancer by the time they walk out, they may well have a subjective improvement in their health. They may feel better. But of course, you're not doing them a favor because you're just giving them a delusion. So it is difficult when one has to be realistic as well as optimistic. For sure,
you know, there's a huge place for simple effective vitamins that isn't looked at in the area.
I think there are enormous amounts of things that can be done, many different things that can be done in terms of not just diet, but in general advice, as you said, to try and boost a person's immune system. So if a person is very sick in that way, a lot of the general advice that you might be able to give that will help with the immune system will also improve, help with quality of life anyway. So I think that it's not, as long as we're, I mean, the Hippocratic, Hippocrates told us that we should first do no harm, and I think that's just one of the basic principles that we should all carry with us. And making sure that the advice that we give is good advice, as good as we can manage anyway. And so we have to ask, we are dealing with questions of people's minds, so we have to know ourselves or have some idea of what we mean by mental health. Because these are all relative things. I think if you look at the total concept of mental health, nobody is totally mentally healthy. Not mentally healthy at all times. And if you get more specifically onto what healthy beliefs are, you start getting running into real problems. One thing is, you could define healthy beliefs as beliefs conducive to improved health. That's a helpful way of defining it. But we, in our society, as doctors anyway, if we've had any kind of psychiatric training, we do somewhat become obsessed with ideas, beliefs and assumptions congruent with reality, or what we consider to be reality. And this becomes a problem because we have to be able to define reality. Do we do it by logic? Do we do it by consensus? Do we do it by expert opinion? You know, what is actually right, even in something as limited as diet? You know, what is a healthy diet? How do we decide what is a healthy diet? If, Professor X, nutritional expert, says that it is a healthy diet, is it right because it's Professor X? Or is it right because the majority of people believe it? Or because the most knowledgeable people? Or because it is actually correct? It's very difficult, and that's part of the morass that we find ourselves in over, like everyone does, anyone who's interested in trying to understand this, and I'm floundering along with everyone else. But we then have to look at ideas, opinions, hypotheses and theories, and how certain or probable are we? Probable is a particular event, and that includes whatever supplement or tablet that we might be talking about, or anything that we're saying, anything that we're thinking. That's why I say, who is really correct about all of those things? The person would have to be right all the time. And yet we are having to give people some advice about these things. So we have to be aware of where the limitations of our own certainty are, and when we are just speculating and when we are correct. Just talked a little bit about healthy emotions very briefly. Do you agree with the first thing, that good moods facilitate happy memories and a positive perception of the self and environment? Right? I believe that quite strongly. And as a result, I showed this to you last time, but it's my little map to try and get things into perspective regarding good moods. This is the speculative bit. On the right side, the good moods and the happiness and the contentment and the health and longevity. I do think bad moods, you can see a number of logical ways in which bad moods can create ill health. But also, emotions are obviously a lot more than moods. People have dynamic emotional reactions. And those emotional reactions have effects on all our systems, right? So today we've really talked about the digestive system, but there are a whole lot of other systems as well alongside. So to a point, when somebody becomes very preoccupied by their diet and their digestive health or their dietary health, if they lose sight of the perspective of all the other aspects of health and the rest of their total health, obviously they're going to not be as healthy as if they can maintain, as I say, a holistic perspective on it. So I think we need to have, to a point we do that with everyone. Somebody who comes in, we decide, is this person a particular risk of heart disease? Is this person a particular risk of something else? It's the clinical judgments that we make. But we should hope that the person will end up with a perspective on it that is going to be healthy for them in the long term. The person goes out just worried about their heart, but not empowered to do anything about it. We haven't really achieved anything very much. And likewise, if they start blaming their diet for everything that they've got, rather than understanding all the complex reasons that they may be unwell and what exactly their ill health is, then again, I don't think we've done them a service. But the other point here is that the emotional reactions have very immediate physiological effects. The effects on the autonomic nervous system are things that happen within seconds rather than minutes or hours. Yeah. So people's physiological state changes quite quickly. Some positive emotions: happiness, pleasure, satisfaction, interest, love, joy, excitement. You could also add to that surprise, amusement. They say laughter is the best medicine. But there are problems with ideas like positive and negative emotions. And that is simply because negative emotions are also very important. If a person has no pain receptors, they won't live very long. And there are people who have no pain receptors and become crippled as a result of it, and because we get signals to move, etc., from pain receptors. And at the same time, I think that a preponderance of those emotions, most people would accept, is something that they don't want and would like to avoid, and are unhealthy. But some general comments is that positive emotions can be unhealthy in extremes of intensity or inappropriate situations. A person who's very amused at somebody else's suffering would not generally be considered to be a positive emotion. Or negative emotions, although unhealthy in excess, are important for motivation and change. For example, if people are not angry at injustices, there will probably be no efforts to change them. Some healthy attitudes. The reason that I talk about attitudes, I think attitudes can be changed. And by identifying different attitudes, when I'm writing, something like this is really just taking aspects of philosophy. But I think that we need to have a sound philosophy underpinning our preventive medicine in particular. And medicine, philosophy shouldn't be completely divorced from ideas of clinical practice. I think we need to have some sort of philosophy behind what we're doing, and hopefully a healthy attitude. You're mentioning, when we had our little coffee break, somebody was mentioning about healthy instincts, so that animals have better instincts than we have for something human beings have. I think if you believe Freud and you read a lot of Freud, you'd start believing that people have terrible instincts. Even there are even recent people, I've read some psychological views that people don't have instincts, which I found a very strange idea, that animals have instincts but humans don't have instincts, or something along those lines. This is a list, this is my own list, which I developed about 5 years ago by studying, my daughter was 2.5 at the time. And I was just struck, I mean, my mother said, it's not from the psychology textbooks because it's so obvious, right? I say it's from the psychology textbooks for different reasons. Actually, curiosity was considered to be a pathological thing. There were lots of people who wrote about the dangers of curiosity. Tied in with the idea of curiosity, kill the cat, and all these things. But the point is, instincts, in a sense, I don't think can be changed. We have our instincts. And I don't think that list, even though I think we also have territorial instincts and we have instincts that can be destructive, at the same time, we also have some healthy instincts which can be adapted and used in a therapeutic way. The reason that I point this out is, if you try and give somebody advice which is completely contrary to their instincts, is quite unlikely to be successful. Some unhealthy attitudes: hostility, aggression, arrogance, condescension, cowardice, bitterness, inadequacy. Of course, we have to identify them in ourselves, first of all, and try and do something about it. And finally, the physician's forgotten tools. The physician's forgotten tools were written in response to the idea that somebody said to me that patients feel cheated if they don't go out with the script. And I don't think it's true. But it does help to write down your advice on a piece of paper so that they've got something to carry out with them. And advice, I think, is really important here. In other words, So silence as well. Silence has a massive therapeutic effect, and also the only way we can truly understand our patients is by actually sitting there quietly and listening to them and finding out what they're saying. And one of the things, for example, that when you talk about stomach ulcers, David Wignall, who I think may have lectured you, I mean, David and I were talking about the possibility that people who have something gnawing at them, you know, they think that something's gnawing at them, not literally gnawing at them, but a problem gnawing at them, or something that they're finding difficult to digest, or something that that these metaphors, the way people use words themselves, can have a direct effect on causing physiological problems. People do sometimes use these terms. People think in terms of words quite often, and I don't know how many studies have actually been done looking at these sort of things, the association between different words and actually causing a similar disease state. And I mean, I can, particularly in terms of stomach ulcers, I can think of a number of words that could have inferences psychologically and cause or connections with actually causing a problem like ulceration. So I think just listening carefully to people's words helps us understand some of the reasons that they might become ill. And I'll leave you with a map that I showed you last time, which is just connecting all of it together. I encourage everybody to, anybody to do that. Not copy it, just do it for them, do it for yourselves, you know. All you have to do is take all the little bits of healing mechanisms that we have been taught little by little, in little bits, and try and put them all together as much as possible. That's all I've tried to do today, is try and, I don't think I've said anything that is particularly new, but I've tried to integrate it and bring it together. But the mind and the digestive system is only one small way in which the mind affects our health. So we have to keep on integrating more and more.